CSS is really fun, but sometimes can be really frustrating. And one of the things that a lot of people ask me about, I've done a video actually on ems and rems before, but I get questions about it all the time, when to use which one. And I really want to focus on looking at why you got to be careful with those ems. They can cause some crazy, weird, cascading things, explode in font sizes, you don't get what's going on. So in this week's video, that's exactly what we are looking at. Hi there, my name is Kevin, and if you're new to this channel, here we learn how to make the web and how to make it look good while we're at it with weekly tips, tricks, and tutorials. And as I just said in the intro bit, we're going to be looking at this crazy cascading problem that ems can give us and why we maybe shouldn't use them in our typography too much. And we're also going to look at how we can. We're going to start with an unrealistic sort of example that clearly illustrates it, and then we'll move into an exaggerated example of something you might actually run into in the real world. But before we get to that, I just want to say a big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this week's video. If you don't know about Skillshare, it's a really awesome course platform. There's just so much material on there, I don't really know where to start. I've talked about it before. I mentioned specifically Rachel Andrews' course on CSS Grid. But if you already know about that, you've already watched that course because you went through on the last link and you're just looking for other stuff, there's tons of, just type in CSS and there's lots of stuff. I'm assuming you like CSS because you're here on my channel and that's what we do here. But so there's tons of really awesome courses, full builds, really cool tutorials. Maybe you're happy with CSS, you're just following along, but you want to get more into design. I get lots of questions about that. They have so many courses just on web design and getting better at design. Or maybe you have a small business that you're looking into doing stuff. They have business courses, they have Photoshop, Illustrator, just so much stuff. I'm super comfortable with Photoshop. I was still like blasting through a whole bunch of courses on there, just learning some really cool stuff the other day. So yeah, I like it. Their content in there is really good. There's so much stuff. You can just keep going and going and going. So it's really, really cool. I really strongly encourage that you go check them out. And if you're one of the first 500 people to use the link down below in the description, it's right there. It's the first thing you'll see in the description. It will give you a free 2-month free trial. 2 months for free. I mean, you can't really ask for much more than that. So go and check them out, see, burn through as much content as you can in there and enjoy it because there's so much content. It's really an awesome platform. So a big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this week's video. With all that out of the way, let's go and check out ems and the problems they cause and how you can solve them and when you still do want to be using ems. All right, so we're going to start off here with a slightly not so realistic example, but then we're going to push into some realism and something you might run into. But I think this unrealistic example is the best way to illustrate exactly what's going on when we use ems for our font sizes. So you can hear I've already started setting up things with ems for my font sizes all over the place here. So if we look here though, so my font size is 1.125m, which is my paragraph, which is this one. So you can see that is a little bit bigger than my list here. I might go, oh man, I want my list to also use this. And let's exaggerate this. We're going to end up with a pretty big font size right now. We're going to boost it up like that. And I go, I want that and my ULs to both be using this font size. And I know we normally maybe put a body font size, but just again, bear with me, maybe not the most realistic example, but look what just happened. This one looks fine. This is big and holy moly, like we're, what's, what, oh, I just don't know what to say for that. So what we can do is, I think we can bring this back down to maybe the 1.25. It's exaggerating more than I thought it would. So we can see here, like big, bigger, big, like holy moly, and if it kept going it would get worse. So what's happening is ems compound on each other. When ems are used as a font size, they look at their parent's font size to know what to be set to. So if we go and look at the markup on this, we have our paragraph, so that's at the font size we set, and then we have this ul here. So this ul has the font size of 1.125. So we have the font size here of font size 1.125m, which equates to whatever it does. But then in here we have another UL. So this is taking that, whatever, so say that equals what? Probably like 18 pixels. We have that, but then what's happening here is it's going, well, this is actually going to multiply by this number. So we're actually getting m times 1.125. And then the next one is going to take all of that and it's going to multiply by 1.125. Multiply by 1.125 because it's taking this number and then we're multiplying it again by 1.125. So we end up with like this massive font size problem that's going on. again, maybe you're not running into this problem with lists. I doubt you are, but it could come up. It's something that, you know, isn't out of the realm of impossibility. But let's get rid of this list for now and take a look at something a little bit more realistic that maybe you'd run into, which is something like a separate component, like a call to action that I've put right here. So on a call to action, you might say something like, I want my call to action to have a larger font size because it's more important. I want this maybe to stand out. I want people to see it. So I set my font size on my call to action to 1.2m. So I want this, you know, this is for here. I want this to be a bit bigger. Now on the title, maybe our title's fine, or maybe, you know, why not? Let's put a font size of 2.5m on the title. So that gets a little bigger. Let's actually boost that one up to 3. So like this has gotten really big, but you know, it's because it's not actually 3M. It's a lot bigger than 3M because it's 3M times 1.2 times, do I have another thing on there? No, I didn't set a body font size because this could be compounded even more. So this is getting big, but then this button is becoming massive. So let's go back to my markup again, because so I have my H2, so it's getting compounded by like the double M thing going on here. This is getting compounded to be bigger than I would have anticipated, because on my, let's come back to my, my call to action body has a font size on it as well. So this is compounding against that one. And then we have my button here, which has a font size on it as well, which is compounded a whole bunch of times because this button happens to be inside of a paragraph. So that button is getting compounded as well and ends up much, much bigger than I would have hoped or anticipated that it would be. So this is really where, instead of using M for font sizes, I'm going to really encourage that you use rems instead. So let's switch all these over to R. We could do this a faster way, but I'm just going to scroll down so we can see if I get them all and hit save. And everything becomes a bit more manageable and a lot easier to deal with and handle. And actually, we're going to get rid of this one for a moment, so this actually gets a bit smaller. There we go. So we get rid of that compounding issue that we had, and we actually know what sizes things are going to be because rems are referring to the root M. So the root, you could actually choose your root like this. You've probably seen that with custom variables at one point or another. But the root, in essence, is just your HTML element. So it's stealing the font size from here. So by default, the font size is 16 pixels in, I think, all browsers, but that can change depending on user settings and a few other things that can come in. But it pretty much defaults to that. Now, some people like to take this and make it 62.5%, I think. I haven't done this in a long time, but I'm pretty sure it's that, which makes, you know, 16 times that number is equal to 10 pixels. So it makes it easier to know what values you're going to get. So if you put 2 rem, it's going to be 20 pixels. So people sort of like doing that. But the problem, I don't think we need that personally, because then you're sort of having to reset everything. Then you're coming on your body and you're changing your body. I don't know. I'm just so used to, and I find once you start working with rems, you sort of get used to what they're going to be. And you see some text, you know, if you want to go a bit bigger, a bit smaller, you know what 18, I'm pretty sure 18 is 1.125 rem, and you sort of get some numbers that you know work. You might be using a modular scale anyway, in which case, you know, you're not really worrying about your pixel values along the way. And it, because it's always referencing back to the root, so it's always referencing back to the HTML, whether you've declared it or not, you know that even though this is inside of something else, so even though my call to action, we can make this like 5 rem or m, it's going to change my padding because I have the this padding is set to M, but the font sizes in here are not changing. All my font sizes have stayed the same, and it makes it much, much, much more predictable to actually use. So for your font sizes, I really, really would say stick to rem if you're not sure. And when do we use M's then? Well, M's come in when you want to set margins and padding and things like that. So say I have my button here. And button, I always use buttons for this example because if I have my paddings, in this case, it's not referencing the parent. If it's on the font size, we're referencing the parent font size. But if we're on the padding, margin, anything else like that, instead of referencing the parent, it's referencing the font size of that element. So that's really, really important to understand. The M's set on anything else other than font size don't reference the parent. They reference the font size of that element. And I would say it again, but I don't want you to stop watching it. But it's really important to understand that. That's like this core concept. And what's so great about that now is I can take this and change the font size on there, and the padding and margins will grow with it. Or if I need a small button, you know, really small button, the paddings and margins are shrinking and growing with it. Whereas if I set this in rem, so let's go and try that out. These are now set values. Like, this is pretty much like setting it in pixels. It's never going to change. So it's there. If I make my button really, really big, let's just exaggerate that even more, 7. See how small this space is, like compared to what it was before? And I made it too big, so we have some empty space and stuff around it. But like this space, relatively speaking, is completely different. And if we go down to a really small font size, now there's like so much space around there compared to before. So again, if I switch this over to M instead of rem, now my button one, like it's more consistent when my button is shrinking and growing. So if you had like a series of different button sizes, this just makes it your life so much easier. Could be the same for your margins, same for a lot of different things. Now margins, maybe you want one that's consistent and is never going to change, then you can set it in rem. But if you'd like the fact that it's locked in with your font size, sort of like a margin bottom you might put on your paragraphs or on your headings, that will be consistent then with the size of the font and automatically adapt, so you don't have to sort of stress about that or worry about how things like that are changing. Hopefully cleared some stuff up for you, because I know a lot of people seem to struggle with that. And as I'd mentioned before, I had another video on it, a lot of the similar concepts in there, but just with the questions I keep getting on it, I thought it was definitely worth bringing the subject up again and exploring in a little bit of a different way than I originally had. So I hope you learned something along the way. If you use ems or rems in any sort of interesting or strange way, or have any questions about them continuing, please leave a comment down below to let me know about that. If you're wondering why we don't just use pixels, that's a really good question. And it mostly revolves around a few things. We don't want to use necessarily a set value. Using rems also can make our lives a lot easier when it comes to changing font sizes across your whole site, because we're always referencing the root. If you put in a media query where you're just changing the size, the font size of the HTML element, your whole site's just going to, everything's going to change along with it. Now, it's not always perfect, but it can be the first step in just making your life a little bit easier of like, oh, mobile has the HTML as a font size of like 70%, and then that goes up to 90%, and then it goes up to 110%, and just your whole site's updating the font size for your different screens without having to go through all the different font properties that you want to be setting. So that can really come in handy as well. I think that's it. So once again, a big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. If you haven't yet, go grab that 2-month free trial, because again, I really do think it is an awesome platform. As well as Skillshare, I'd also like to thank my patrons for helping support me here as well. And everything I do here, they're supporting me every single week, just helping bring updates and like closed captioning and this microphone, and just making the helping to support what I'm doing here so I can bring higher quality videos to you guys. So really appreciate the support coming from everybody over on Patreon, and double thanks to Fernando, John, and Lauren for being my supporters of awesome. You guys absolutely rock. Thank you so much. If you haven't yet, come and join the community. Come and join us at the community. There's a link down below. It's free to join. Come have fun, hang out, ask questions, and it's a fun place to be. So I really encourage you to come there. And if you haven't signed up for my newsletter, what are you waiting for? If you don't want to miss a video, you can subscribe here, but I also have articles and I do some other stuff. If you subscribe to my newsletter, you'll never miss any content that I do. The link for that obviously is in the description as well. Thank you so much for watching, making it all the way to the end. I hope you learned something. Look forward to seeing you next week. And until then, don't forget to make your corner of the internet just a little bit more awesome.